I said, I'm inclined to think yes, said Sherlock Holmes. I should do that. I'm one of the most long-suffering immortals, but I'll admit that I was annoyed at this sardonic interruption. Really, Holmes, you are a little trying at times. He was too absorbed with his own thoughts to give any immediate answer, staring at the slip of paper he had just drawn from its envelope. I can hardly doubt that it's Porlock's writing. That Greek E with a peculiar top flourish is distinctive, and if it is Porlock, then it must be something of the very first importance. My vexation disappeared in the interest which the words awakened. Who's Porlock? Porlock, Watson, is a nom de plume, but behind it lies a shifty personality. In a former letter he informed me that the name was not his own and defied me ever to trace him among the teeming millions of this great city. Porlock is important, not for himself, but for the great man with whom he is in touch. Picture to yourself the jackal with the lion. You have heard me speak of Professor Moriarty, the famous scientific criminal, the greatest schemer of all time, the organizer of every devilry, the controlling brain of the underworld, but also the celebrated author of The Dynamics of an Asteroid, a book which ascends to such rarefied heights of pure mathematics that it is said there was no man in the scientific press capable of criticizing it. If I am spared by lesser men, one day we will surely cross swords. May I be there to see it, I said. But you were speaking of this man Porlock. Ah, yes, the so-called Porlock is a link in the chain, and not quite a sound link. He is the only flaw in that chain, as far as I have been able to test it. But no chain is stronger than its weakest link. Exactly, my dear Watson. Hence the extreme importance of Porlock. Encouraged by an occasional £10 note sent to him by devious methods, he has once or twice given me advance information of some value. I cannot doubt that if we had the cipher, we should find this communication of the greatest importance. Holmes flattened out the paper. Leaning over him, I stared down at the curious inscription, a series of numbers interspersed with the name Douglas once and Birlstone twice. What do you make of it, Holmes? It is obviously an attempt to convey secret information. But what is the use of a cipher message without the cipher? In this instance, none at all. These numbers clearly refer to the words in a page of some book. Until I know which book, I am powerless. But why Douglas and Birlstone? Because these words were not contained in the page in question. Then why has he not indicated the book? My dear Watson, your native shrewdness would surely prevent you from enclosing cipher and message in the same envelope. I shall be surprised if our second post does not bring us either a further letter of explanation or the very volume to which these figures refer. Holmes's calculation was fulfilled within a very few minutes by the appearance of Billy the page with the very letter that we were expecting, but his brow clouded as he glanced over the contents. Oh, dear me, this is very disappointing. Dear Mr. Holmes, I will go no further in this matter. It is too dangerous. I can see that he suspects me. He came to me quite unexpectedly after I had addressed this envelope intending to send you the key to the cipher. I was able to cover it up, but I read suspicion in his eyes. Please burn the cipher message which can now be of no use to you. Fred Porlock. I picked up the cipher message. I presume he is referring to Professor Moriarty. It's pretty maddening to think that an important secret may lie here on this slip of paper and that it is beyond human power to penetrate it. Sherlock Holmes leaned back and stared at the ceiling. He refers to a book. That is our point of departure. Now, what indications have we as to this book? None. Surely not. The cipher message begins with 534. We may take it as a working hypothesis that 534 is the page to which the cipher refers. So, our book has already become a large book. The next sign is C2. What do you make of that, Watson? The second chapter? But hardly that. If the page is given, the number of the chapter is immaterial. Column, I cried. Brilliant, Watson. So, now, you see, we begin to visualize a large book, printed in double columns, each of considerable length, since one of the words is numbered in the document as the 293rd. Have we reached the limits of what reason can supply? I fear we have. You do yourself an injustice. He did not intend to send me the volume. His intention was to send me the clue in this envelope. He says so in his note. This would seem to indicate that the book is one he thought I would have. He had it, and he imagined that I would too. In short, Watson, it is a large book, printed in double columns and in common use. The Bible, I cried. Good, Watson, but not quite good enough. The editions of Holy Writ are too numerous. This is clearly a book which is standardized. He knows for certain that his page 534 will exactly agree with my page 534. Oh, but very few books would correspond with that. Exactly. So our search is narrowed down to standardized books, which anyone may be supposed to possess. An almanac. Excellent, Watson. Let us consider the claims of Whitaker's almanac. It is in common use. It has the requisite number of pages. It is in double columns. He picked the volume from his desk. Here is page 534, column 2, a substantial block of print dealing, I perceive, with the trade and resources of British India. Jot down the words, Watson. Number 13 is there. Number 127 is. There is. Holmes's eyes were gleaming with excitement as he counted the words. Danger. Put this down, Watson. There is danger. May come very soon. Then we have the name Douglas. Rich, country, now at Birlstone House. Birlstone, confidence is pressing. There, Watson, the meaning is perfectly clear. Some devilry is intended against one Douglas, whoever he may be, residing as stated. He is sure, confidence was as near as he could get to, confident that it is pressing. There is our result, and a very workmanlike little bit of analysis it was. Holmes displayed the impersonal joy of the true artist. He was still chuckling over his success when Billy swung open the door and Inspector MacDonald of Scotland Yard was ushered into the room. Holmes was not prone to friendship, but he was tolerant of the big Scot. "You're an early bird, Mr. Mac. I fear this means that there is some mischief afoot." "If you said hope instead of fear," said the inspector, "it would be nearer the truth. I'm thinking, Mr. Holmes, but... He was staring with a look of absolute amazement at the paper upon which I had scrawled the enigmatic message. "Douglas Birlstone? What's this, Mr. Holmes? Man, it's witchcraft. Where in the name of all that is wonderful did you get those names?" "It is a cipher that Dr. Watson and I have had occasion to solve. But why? What's amiss with the names?" The inspector looked from one to the other of us. "Just this. Last night, Mr. Douglas, a Birlstone manor house, was brutally murdered." It would be an overstatement to say that my friend was shocked, or even excited by the amazing announcement. "Remarkable," he said. "You don't seem surprised. Why should I be? I receive an anonymous communication from a quarter which I know to be important, warning me that danger threatens a certain person. Within an hour, I learn that this danger has actually materialized and that the person is dead. I am interested, but as you observe, I am not surprised." In a few short sentences, he explained to the inspector the facts about the letter and the cipher. "I was going down to Birlstone this morning," said MacDonald. "I had come to ask if you cared to come with me, you and your friend here." MacDonald turned over the letter which Holmes had handed him. "You think there's someone behind this, Porlock?" "I know there is." "This professor that I've heard you mention?" "Exactly," Inspector MacDonald smiled. "I won't conceal from you, Mr. Holmes, that we think in the CID that you have a wee bit of a bee in your bonnet over this professor. After I heard your view of him, I made it my business to see him. I had a chat with him. How the talk turned to eclipses, I cannot think, but he had out a reflector lantern and a globe and made it all clear in a minute. He'd have made a grand minister with it."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.